I'm Charles Kuralt. We'll celebrate the lives of Americans who died this year but left us something to remember them by this Sunday morning.
This is CBS.
Moments like this that really put me in the mood for some good soft rock music. And Session's new Everlasting Love album is perfect for these occasions. Just listen.
Touch me in the morning.
How can I be sure
you are so beautiful?
Everlasting Love contains 40 great hits by the original artists. Here's more.
Hold me, never let me go until you've told me. Ooh, are you laughter in the rain?
Last night, I didn't get to sleep at all.
Help me make it.
Everlasting Love is available on 4 records or 3 cassette tapes for only $19.95. 2 compact discs, only $24.95. Here's how to order.
Credit card and COD customers call toll-free 1-800-234-5090 or save COD fees by sending $19.95 for 4 records or 3 cassettes or $24.95 for 2 compact discs. Plus $4 shipping and handling to Everlasting Love, P.O. Box 4444-C, Colorado Springs, Colorado.
The pros and cons of peer pressure, Saturday in our lives.
I'm John Palmer. When most of us go to work each day, we expect to come home with a paycheck and satisfaction of a job well done. We don't expect to risk our lives or change the world. Alina Jmont took on a dangerous task. As one of the first women aquanauts chosen to live underwater, she refused to let male chauvinism keep her on shore. L.J. Delsa put his life on the line because that was his job. As a police officer, he helped save New Orleans from a senseless act of terror. So stand firm. You're about to experience instant recall. They dive into the ocean with a double mission. The first is to survive, but the second is harder, to prove that women can do the job.
I've never experienced anything since. This kind of pressure to perform as a female.
A murder investigation sparks an unprecedented shooting match. An entire police force must face a deadly one-man army.
The shots that were made that killed policemen from across the street were like an Olympic shooter. I mean, he was running around making shots that the ordinary man could never make.
Also ahead, California Dreamin' becomes a reality, the singing success of the Mamas and the Papas. Our first story takes place on July 6, 1970. It's a time when the idea of equal rights for women has barely surfaced. But on this day, a team of female aquanauts, 5 women who are referred to as aqua gals, aqua babes, and aqua maids, are about to deepen the feminist foothold in the name of science.
I'd like to be under the sea in an octopus's garden in the shade.
Journal of the 2-week tour to the octopus's garden, July 6, 1970.
Splashdown. 5 women descend to the ocean floor. Their mission to help open a new frontier. The project is Tektite 2. For 2 weeks, they will live 50 feet under the Caribbean in a high-tech habitat. They will study the ocean floor while NASA studies them. This will be the first time American scientists have worked isolated in this alien world.
People were talking about living underwater and underwater cities, and so this is like the beginning, possibly, of something new.
We could go diving at night and see the stars and the moon from a depth of 50 feet. We could get to know individual fish and stay with them for hours and hours.
But before Alina Schmont and Sylvia Earle and their teammates broke the ocean surface, serious obstacles threatened to sink their efforts.
I just took for granted that they meant what they said. They asked for scientists who had an interest in getting involved with this project. When they saw that there were women who had applied who were at least as qualified as many of the men, they didn't know what to do.
The federal officials planning the project decide that women and men must not work together in the habitat.
American society was not ready to have people cohabitating underwater, even if they were married. So I guess at that point they decided that if they were going to include women, it would have to be as an all-female team.
It was a major step forward to put down females at all. And we had all of the male chauvinistic comments of the time, like, well, if they happen to have a menstrual period, they would attract sharks. And that would be a disaster, of course, everybody thought.
Program director James Miller doesn't budge. He's determined that one team of women will join 10 teams of men. His colleagues question his judgment.
They would say, like, well, are you sure you want to do this? Are you sure you're going to get any scientific results out of this? There was a little jealousy, I think, among some of the male aquanauts that, gee, we're doing everything those girls are doing, and they're getting all the publicity.
Flip Schulke is one of the male aquanauts. He is also a photojournalist who will document all 11 missions. To his dismay, news editors keep making the same request.
They wanted the skimpiest bathing suits as possible, and, be sure they're wearing, if you can get them to wear light rubber suits so that their breasts will show from a profile. No, it was very blunt.
It captured the imagination of people, but we were dead serious about what we were there to do.
They really didn't think that we were going to be able to handle the physically demanding parts of the mission. All of the diving was with double steel tanks, which weigh about 60, 70 pounds. Just lifting that up and putting it on your back is a bit of an effort. But what we told them was that where we didn't have brawn, we had brains, and that by working together cooperatively, we'd figure how to get it all done.
We would be so happy, you and me. No one there to tell us what to do.
July 6, 1970, the true test begins. After months of skepticism and weeks of intense training, the women take their turn in the habitat.
The girls were all very happy to get down in the habitat and get on with what they came down to do. So I think it was a feeling of relief. By golly, we got them down.
I just didn't want to sleep. I just, given a chance, I would have been in the water all the time.
It was totally overwhelming, just the feeling of, wow. The unfortunate part is that we were all very tired by the time we got there, and there was tension starting to build up. We really had to start showing that we could not only meet but exceed the men's expectations.
Everybody's asking, how are you doing? How are you getting along down there? They wanted us not to get along, I sometimes thought.
For 2 weeks, the scrutiny never stops. NASA-sponsored psychologists study the women as the women study the fish.
Every 6 minutes, they would note what each of the five aquanauts was doing.
I've never experienced anything since, this kind of pressure to perform as a female. It was not just a piece of cake being there underwater, looking beautiful or anything like that.
If some people tried to sign it off to say, well, it's because they're playing on the stage. It's because of the media attention. In fact, it was in spite of all of that attention.
They put more time in the water collectively than any of the male teams. They published good scientific papers in good scientific journals.
It was very well known at the end of the project that the women's mission was the most successful part of the whole thing.
After 2 weeks are up, the aquanauts enter a decompression chamber to bring the nitrogen level in their blood back to normal. When they re-enter the world above sea level, some things will never be the same.
It made me more aware, I guess, of the responsibility each of us has as professional women in making it easier for other women to have careers, to do the things they want to do.
Alina Jmont is now an assistant professor of marine biology at the University of Miami. Dr. Sylvia Earle is the chief scientist at the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration in Washington, D.C. She will soon be conducting research in an underwater habitat for the seventh time. Dr. James Miller is the author of several books about underwater habitats. Flip Schulke won several awards for his film coverage of Tektite 2. He has since done pioneering work in adapting lenses for underwater photography. Scientific experiments with underwater habitats have come a long way since the Tektite 2 project. Not only is it now routine for women to participate, but most missions are now co-ed. Next, another moment, another time, on Instant Recall. A suspected killer goes on a rampage and turns a New Orleans motel into a battle zone, and an entire police force into an unwilling army. Also, how four flower children grew up to be the mamas and the papas of the love generation.
This Saturday is Luskin's biggest sale of the year, with drastic markdowns on electronics and appliances. This RCA 20-inch stereo remote TV, $277 or less. This Sherwood CD player, $99 or less. The Panasonic palm quarter, $788 or less. This GE heavy-duty washer, $256 or less. This RCA 46-inch projection TV, $1799 and $150 a blockbuster. And this 12-inch black and white TV buyout, $49.97 plus free stereo headphones. The low overhead, low price leader has done it again this Saturday only. The biggest sale of the year at Luskin's, the cheapest guy in town.
Sometimes the hardest thing about having a disability is that people meet it before they meet you.
Hey, Richard. You met everybody?
It's the month before Christmas, and all through the town, creatures are stirred, including this clown. Parties are going, filled with good cheer. Alcohol's flowing, booze, wine, and beer.
The thing that is special as the clock ticks past five is the ones who are drinking are the ones that won't drive.
It's the holiday season, so go have some fun. But when it comes to a driver, designate one.
Are on Arsenio.
Stop by, Pebbles will be here, Nell Carter will be here.
That's not all.
Delight will be here, Charlton Heston will be here.
More?
Shirley Ralph will be here, Casey Osmond will be here, supermodel Paulina will be here.
No kidding.
The whole family, they'll all be here.
If they're hot, they're on Late Night Cool.
It's true. Weeknights at 11:30.
Beginning January 1st, Arsenio's on the one and only Channel 9.
Our next story takes place on January 7th, 1973. That morning, it looked like a slow news day in New Orleans. Some journalists gather in the Latin Quarter to cover a jazz festival. Suddenly, they see smoke billowing from the windows of a nearby hotel. A routine fire, they think, but local policemen know better. They warn a gathering crowd to take cover. Within minutes, four of the officers have been shot. Their comrades must stop a sniper who's already proven he has deadly aim.
January 7th, 1973 would probably be the most terrifying day I've ever spent.
The adrenaline was just pumping 1,000 miles an hour.
It's like it was yesterday.
New Orleans, 10:30 Sunday morning. Officers investigating the New Year's Eve slaying of a police cadet track suspected killer Mark Essex to the downtown Howard Johnson's motel. Essex is enraged by what he considers racist treatment of him in the military service. He runs from floor to floor, setting fires, shooting anyone who gets in his path.
Soon, Essex will train his gun on the people in the street below with terrifying accuracy. Officers Earl Hardwin and L.J. Delsa are among the police who go in after Essex. Their mission? Drive him to the roof.
We grabbed some shotguns and a bandolero filled with ammunition.
We started taking the stairwell instead of elevators. We're running into smoke floors. We're running into bodies on the stairwells, you know, of people that he was killing at the time.
We were going on a room-to-room search, and it turned out that we had a lot of people that had barricaded themselves in the rooms. They had no idea what was going on. They thought a revolution had broken out, some of them. They were just in a crazed state.
We engaged him a couple of times on the floors. It was smoked up areas. So you didn't actually see Essex. What you saw was a shadow.
It was terrifying. Numerous times, I remember one time laying on my stomach in the hallway, watching one of the entrances, just continually asking myself, what are you doing here?
Across the street, someone sees smoke and calls the fire department. Fire Lieutenant Tim Urson arrives on the scene, responding to what he thinks is a routine call.
We looked up. There was smoke coming out of about the ninth floor of the building. I saw four or five people out on the balcony screaming, hollering. Well, I started up the ladder. Between the sixth and seventh floors, I was getting a little tired. I was having problems with my equipment. So I stopped for a few seconds, and when I reached up for the rung to pull myself up, boom, everything went blurry.
Urson has been spotted by the sniper and shot.
It hit me in my left forearm. I looked back down, and I could see the blood running out of my raincoat like tomato juice. It was just pouring out, you know. And then I realized then if I didn't get down, I was going to bleed to death or fall.
Fireman Huey Brown climbs up to Urson and carries him down. Photographer Jerry Arnold hears about the fire and drives over to take a look.
When I got there, they had a fireman. The first thing I saw was a fireman laying on the ground and a police officer leaning up against a fire engine with a rifle. Then somebody hollered, there's a policeman injured in the building. So I went over. And a priest and crash truck people were bringing out a police officer. Shots rang out again, and I looked over, and there was two policemen against a tree. It was like World War II. An ambulance driver had been shot right up in front of me, but at that time, I was too scared to move.
The shots that were made to kill policemen from across the street were like an Olympic shooter. I mean, he was running around making shots that the ordinary man could never make.
With sharpshooters in position, officers inside the hotel finally drive Essex to the roof, sealing off his only route to escape. Within the hour, police order a Marine helicopter to the scene to help dislodge the killer.
Some of the police got into the helicopters with this Marine colonel. We laid bulletproof vests on the floor of the helicopter to protect the men, because as they went over a couple of times, Essex came out of the stairwell and fired at the helicopter.
After nightfall, the helicopter begins a series of passes over the roof of the motel, exchanging gunfire with the sniper. Police sharpshooters on nearby rooftops flush Essex from hiding. As he runs across the roof, he's hit by a barrage of bullets and dies instantly. The siege is over. Police are stunned by the unprecedented bloodbath. Mark Essex has killed 9 people and wounded 19. Fireman Tim Urson will lose a hand. For all those swept up in the tragedy, the carnage is seared into their memories forever.
January 7th, 1973. That's when my career ended. The thing I love to do the most.
We realized that we wasn't a superman we thought we were.
January 7th, 1973, I grew up.
L.J. Delsa and Earl Hardwin are still with the New Orleans Police Department. Tim Urson was forced to retire from the fire department after his injuries. In 1973, most local police had no comprehensive strategy for dealing with hostage situations. As a result of the Howard Johnson's incident, New Orleans and other cities have since trained special SWAT teams to deal with snipers and terrorists. Next, the musical blossom of 4 flower children. They shared the free-loving, free-wheeling dream of the 60s and turned it into a song. The Mamas and the Papas and the true story behind California Dreamin'.
So this is Christmas, and what have you done?
changing a child's life from poverty and despair to health and happiness with one phone call and just 70 cents a day. You can. Call now to see how you can sponsor a girl or boy through Christian Children's Fund. Just 70 cents a day can provide a needy child, that child's family and community, with food, medical care, schooling, a future.
So this is Christmas. For weak and for strong. The rich and the poor ones. The road is so long.
For the price of a cup of coffee, you can become the most important person in one child's life. Through letters and photos, you'll see the difference you've made firsthand. You'll be amazed at just how much love your caring can bring. Call CCF now for information with no obligation. You can sponsor a girl or boy from any one of 22 countries around the world. You can even sponsor a child right here in the U.S. And over 80% of every dollar you entrust to CCF goes directly to help your sponsored child. A phone call now, just 70 cents a day, so little to do. But to a child who needs your help, it's the most wonderful Christmas present you could ever give. Of a cup of coffee, you can become the most important person in a child's life. Call CCF today.
They were young musicians inspired by the rhythm of the 60s. They lived on love and an American Express card. They turned on, tuned in, and when their credit dropped out, they didn't give up. After several years of roaming, they found their voice, and the mamas and the papas became the sound of a generation. If You Can Believe Your Eyes and Ears hits the top of the charts in May of 1966. It produces two hit singles and a Grammy. Work on the album began a few years earlier. John and Michelle Phillips and their singing partner, Denny Doherty, were spending several months in the Virgin Islands looking for musical inspiration. It was there they ran into Cass Elliott, an old friend of Denny's. The four decided to sing together and later took the name the Mamas and the Papas. When their money ran out, they headed north to the mainland.
The Caribbean is beautiful. It's paradise. The blue, it was hanging in the green. And we get back to New York and it was...
Michelle had never seen snow in her entire life, you know, and never been cold because she lived in Southern California. She said, I'm going to go out and walk it. And so we went out and walked at it. And all she had were like California clothes. And we walked for a while and stopped into a church to get warm because we were cold, not to pray. And
that evening, John got inspired. He asked Michelle to help him write a song.
She said, leave me alone. Leave me alone. I'm trying to sleep. I've had this terrible day. There's stuff falling out of the sky. And I'm walking around in it with, you know, no socks.
And I said, well, I'll help you write it tomorrow. He said, no, come on. Help me write it now.
I said, just write this down, you'll never regret it. And you can ask Michelle to this day, she's never regretted it.
There aren't enough songs to complete an album, and Denny began pushing John to write some more.
Okay, Al, I'm going to sit down and write his song tonight. It's about a universal subject.
Monday night, what is this? It's a little song about a day of the week.
I just said, God, John, I hate to be so negative, but this song is really pretentious. It shot to the top of the charts, faster than any record we ever had, and is to this day still the biggest record that the Mamas and Papas ever had.
Who knew? Who knew?
This is another number one record.
Well, I guess I was stupid me. What do I know?
I like it now, too. I like it a lot.
Oh, Monday, Monday, how could you leave and not take me here?
The Mamas and the Papas broke up in 1968. Cass Elliot died in 1974 at the age of 32. There were rumors she choked on a ham sandwich, but an autopsy showed obesity led to a massive heart attack. Denny Doherty went on to become an actor in Canada. Michelle Phillips is now starring in the television series Knots Landing. She and her ex-husband John recently published individual autobiographies. Their daughter China now sings in her own band, Wilson Phillips. The entire story of the Mamas and the Papas, called Straight Shooter, is available on Rhino Home Video. Next, a controversial prize Pulitzer. Monday on Instant Recall, she can swim circles around anybody, even the island of Manhattan. Also, from Hollywood saint to fallen star, the passionate love affair that nearly brought Ingrid Bergman to ruin.
What would it take to get you to change from Advil or Tylenol? How about New Bear Plus?
Bear Plus has Bear Aspirin for powerful pain relief.
And Stomach Guard to help prevent stomach upset.
So bang pain back.
With a wonder drug that's got it all, New Bear Plus.
Dropping off your film is like dropping off your kids. You worry.
Bye, son. See you soon.
Relax. If you see this Kodak Color Watch seal, they'll get great developing.
Saturday is Luskin's biggest sale of the year, with drastic markdowns on electronics and appliances. This RCA 20-inch stereo remote TV, $277 or less. This Sherwood CD player, $99 or less. The Panasonic Palm Quarter, $788 or less. This GE heavy-duty washer, $256 or less. This RCA 46-inch projection TV, $1799 and $150 a blockbuster. And this 12-inch black and white TV buyout, $49.97 plus free stereo headphones. The low overhead, low price leader has done it again this Saturday only. The biggest sale of the year at Luskin's, the cheapest guy in town.
Hello, I'm Hank Yagi. The holidays are a time for reflection on the year past and the opportunities for the year ahead. As this year ends, we find ourselves wishing just a little harder for peace, and our hearts go out to those who cannot be together. To you, we hope the coming year brings realized dreams and answered prayers. We at WUSA pledge to continue serving you with quality news, information, and entertainment programming you've come to expect. Happy holidays from the one and only Channel 9.
Provided by Hilton. We've invested over $1 billion to raise the standard of what a great hotel should be, and that's just the beginning. Hilton, it's all in the name.
We end with a moment from 8 years ago today, December 28, 1982. There are charges of drug use, incest, death threats, adultery, and lesbian affairs. It's a Palm Beach divorce trial that's making national headlines, even too sensational for a family used to being in the news. A $25 million fortune and custody of twin sons are at stake. And after 19 days of lurid testimony, publishing heir Peter Pulitzer wins the case. 8 years ago today, a Florida judge rules that Pulitzer's third wife, Roxanne, is guilty of gross misconduct. He awards her a $48,000 settlement and lets her keep only her jewelry and a black Porsche and a 3-foot trumpet. We leave you now with a top 10 song from that day, Man Eater by Hall and Oates. Until other moments and other times, I'm John Palmer.
Oh, here she comes. Watch out, boy. Watch out for me.